of Saint Jerome, the Bible translator, who is considered the patron saint of translators. The idea behind the celebration is to show solidarity of the worldwide translation community and to display pride in a profession that is becoming increasingly essential in the era of progressive globalization. The evidence suggests that there is a solid reason to take part in the Translators Day competition. This has some appeal for freshmen who'll get a taste of their future career and challenge-loving sophomores, while third-year students may get a better idea of what their practical training will involve. Individually, you are given an excellent opportunity to polish your skills in a friendly environment to help improve your team's average score and to impress and inspire and, well, just hang around with like-minded people. Before we begin, let me introduce our most honorable and advised jury who will give you their undivided attention. Assistant Professor Anna Mikhailovna Ivanova. Assistant Professor Marina Arkadyevna Fomina will join us a little later. And final lecturer, Alexander Kutovsky. The contestants with the higher number of votes will become the ultimate winners. It's an open secret that Translators' Day brings a particular intensity of cares to the formally ordered life of all the students. Year in and year out, it requires impressive efforts to rise to the standards set by the Chair of Linguistics and Translation Studies. But why not try and go for the gold? So let's get it all started with our very first challenge. The task was to come up with a 3-minute-long audio guide intended for a museum of your own choice. The intricacies of this type of translation lie in the fact that it is aimed at helping the listener wade through the numerous rooms. Okay, we need to welcome it. And exhibitions with no assistant but your voice and their earphones. Let's see what you've evoked. So please welcome group 201 to the stage. Let's go.
The Moscow Imperial University established a cabinet of natural history, which with time evolved into the Zoological Museum. At the beginning of the 20th century, a separate building was constructed for it on the Bolshevikiskaya Street, which is still referred to when talking about the museum. The exposition brings only modern animals into the spotlight, except for a full mammoth skeleton which towers above the visitors on the second floor. All fossil remains were transferred to the Moscow Paleontological Museum. The first floor of the lower hall mainly brings into focus the variety of animals from monocyte ones to reptiles. Above it is the higher hall, accounting for birds and mammals. An exhibition of comparative anatomy called the bone hall is also located there. Its exposition tackles an internal structure of vertebrate animals. The Biolectorium is open to the public as well and will change your view on many involving issues such as how the giraffe grows spots in its body and why. The museum has team-related classes held in an interactive setting with independently done tasks, including work with natural objects.
The
The second floor alleyway features an exposition called The Museum in the History of the Moscow University. It follows the museum since its establishment to modern days. Various halls of the museum showcase works of outstanding Russian animal artists. The museum hosts regular exhibitions as well.
Dear visitors, the Museum of Chocolate History in Kharkov was created in 2009 on the basis of three Moscow museums such as Rosneftsabor, confectionery goods from Bavarivsky, and Rotfond, that are members of the Integrated Confectioners Holding. Throughout all existence history, the factories made candies, waffles, caramel, and of course chocolate as the very first unknown dessert in the world, which has become the main hero of the new museum. The emergence of the Mishkan Museum has become a significant milestone in chocolate museum's history development. Nowadays, this cultural foundation is the largest and most sought among the similar museums. Take into consideration that the journey into the chocolate history begins with the exposition devoted to the Maya civilization, because these people were the first in entrance from Kharkov. Then, visitors get to the ship of conquistadors who have brought chocolate to Europe. The first chocolate and candies packings and advertisement are also presented in the museum. Dear visitors, for your convenience, we have a huge e-book which follows you together and flip through and at a leisurely pace consider colorful illustrations, cartoons, and films telling about the individual pages of the chocolate history. The focus of all the chocolate stories is the cocoa tree. It has all the branches of plants presented in the exhibition. Unlike most museums, here it is allowed to touch many exhibits. The museum exposition consists of three rooms with a total area more than 600 square meters, within which, since ancient times, the whole history of man's use of cocoa beans is revealed. Let's go into the first room. This room shows the period of the chocolate discovered by South American Indians, its cultivation, and first manufacturing methods. Here you can see the ancient vessels as well as illustrative examples of how, in the old days, the grains of cocoa beans were in fact equated with monetary unit. Let us move further. In this hall, you can see a layout of the colonizer's ship that was used to deliver chocolate to Europe. Let us proceed. In this hall, you can get acquainted with the confectionery industry of the Soviet period. You can see very popular Russian candies such as Mishka Kosolapy, Alyonka, Belochka, Karakum, and well-known New Year presents with sweets and so on. The museum symbol is a giant 85-pound teddy bear made of pure chocolate. Teddy bear is kept in a glass cabinet with specially created environment. Dear visitors, in the framework of the exhibition, all visitors are offered to taste a few cocoa drinks. For those who are interested, we have a special room where you can enjoy a mission-related 3D film. Here you can learn how chocolate is produced, from plantations to production department, and finally, its designing. Moreover, the film will tell you about the history of Maya's script key, make you smile, and at the same time, feel sorrow for the Columbus's and Cortez's journeys. It can also help you to visit Latino American cocoa plantations. Besides, you have a great opportunity to watch an exclusive Soviet video about chocolate, which was created in the 1930s. In our museum store, you can also buy books and DVDs about the chocolate producing as well as its history. Also, you can buy stickers, bookmarks, and other stuff, which will always remind you about your visit and impression.
The State Tretiakov Gallery possesses a unique collection of Russian art. It includes masterpieces which span a period of 1,000 years. Nowadays, our collection contains more than 170,000 books by Russian artists, from early religious paintings to modern art. It is quite problematic just to look over all the exhibits at once. So today we would like to demonstrate a selection of the 6 remarkable and most prominent masterpieces. Now you're entering the 7th hall. On the right hand side, you can see Vasily Perov's piece, The Hunter's Interest. The following scene is revealed. The eldest person, on the left, narrates a fictional story. And the young hunter, on the right, adds in every word spoken. But the middle-aged man, in the center, is skeptical about the tale and sneers. Experts tend to draw a parallel between Perov's picture and the hunter's sketches by Turgenev. In the 16th hall, we can see the theft painting by Vasily Bukharin, The Unequal Marriage. It depicts a wedding ceremony of an elderly man and a young, grievous girl. There is a lot of evidence that this painting might be autobiographical. Bukharin's former bride gets married to the rich nobleman, and the person in the background, a young man with arms folded across the chest, might be the painter himself. The 19th hall introduces us to the works of Ivan Konstantinovich Ivazovsky. During his almost 60-year career, he created about 6,000 paintings. The vast majority of his works are seascapes. They are usually made on a large scale and have dramatic plots. But for this painting in front of us, Rainbow, artist chose a softer tone. During the storm, the rainbow appears in the sky, a symbol of salvation. In the 20th hall, we can admire the remarkable painting by Von Kramskoy, Portrait of an Unknown Woman. The charming, fascinating woman is seated in an open carriage at the Anishka Bridge in St. Petersburg. She is dressed in a black fur and velvet coat, fur hat with leather gloves. Kramskoy titled the painting Unknown, and did not mention her in any of his letters or diaries, leading to much speculation, and the painting's highly enigmatic reputation. We hope you enjoyed browsing these masterpieces. Thank you very much for attention, and see you soon at the State Tragedies Gallery.
Physical and spiritual power. He is eager to protect his homeland. He often undertakes sensitive and diplomatic missions. Mezhukovich is the youngest of the three Bogdars. His pattern represents a poetic and contemplative Russian spirit, love to the display of beauty. Lyonushka by Viktor Mikhailovich Kuznetsov. There is also one of the outstanding painting known as Lyonushka. When Kuznetsov avoided a particular plot and situations, he managed to show in the painting the main idea of a Russian fairy tale, which is linked to the Russian character. The artist showed the suffering of a shy and lonely orphan who was turned down everywhere. It is the most common story in many tales. Alyosha sits on the stone for so long that it seems that she has turned on stone herself, and now there is only despair in her eyes. The girl's eyes attract you as if they were deep waters. Their depth and darkness reveal a shadowy reflection and tempt Alyosha to enter the waters. It seems that the girl's figure is created from natural forms such as faded evening colors and patterns of the leaves. They contain the semblance of the autumn nature, which hides and guards the girl carefully. Nature cheers her up as a mother cheers her child. The landscape patterns were inspired by poetic folk images, such as fellows who bear good news, and trembling aspens, which are the tough love symbols. Pine Forest by Ivan Ivanovich Shishkin. Ivan Ivanovich Shishkin is another widely admired artist who wrote the greatest paintings of Russian forests and revealed the beauty of Russian nature. Shishkin and his contemporaries do not separate Russian nature from Russian ideology, its people, and destiny. The painting Pine Forest defines its main theme, which is mighty and majestic Russian forest. The artist creates a scene, produces some kind of a play. There is a good reason for the chosen time of the day. The noon reveals the image of Russia, which is full of dormant internal forces. Thank you for your attention.
Rembrandt, a different perspective. Works of Rembrandt, Hermans van Rijn, and Mitri Goethe. The Pushkin State Museum of Fine Arts, a museum known first and foremost for its classical approach, is participating for the first time in the 6th Moscow Biennale of Contemporary Art in a bid to find an answer to the relevant but also exceptionally complex question of how the art of the old masters interacts with that of contemporary artists. Meanwhile, we are continuing our tradition of experiments in actively but tactically interjecting the art of the 21st century in the museum's permanent exposition. There is a gulf of centuries between rhetoric great Dutch master Rembrandt Hermans van Rijn, 1606-1669, and Mitri Goethe, born in 1960, one of the most original and subtlest Russian artists. But a dialogue between them visualized in the exhibition Rembrandt a different perspective. Goethe, inspired by the drawings of the great Dutchman and employing his own unique and original technique, offers a slightly different, profoundly individual view of the graphic line. In his works, which combine the qualities of sculpture, objects and installation, visual images embodied with the spontaneous brushstrokes of the great Dutch master, pensive old man, beggars, a graceful girl, a baby held on his mother, appear to the stepping off the surface of the paper and materializing in three-dimensional metal structures. The fantastic interweaving of the metal is miraculously transformed into drawing blown up the gigantic size. But the spectator needs only to take one step to the side for the illusion to disintegrate. And the classical images are transformed into abstract shapes. Part of a continuous process of convergence, the material and emptiness create an object of art. The past and the present, the real and the illusory, led together in the spectator's gaze, is one of the key tools in this process. this process.
Museums. And today is a wonderful day to visit the Jesenin Museum and to dig into his life and work. At the beginning of the 20th century, the house on the Большой Стручановский Lane was a hostel for the clerks of Krylov's butchery. Over 30 years, there walked and lived the poet's father, Alexander Jesenin. Большой Стручановский, 24, was Sergei Jesenin's first address in Moscow after he had left his home village in 1912. A commemorative plaque is set on the house front in his honor. In the museum lobby, we can see a poet's statue and a lot of different flowers and herbs that illustrate a part of Jesenin's birthplace, Konstantinov. When he moved, he said, "The most beautiful place I've ever seen in the world is Moscow." To the right side of the entrance, we can see the white hall of the museum and find there a lot of his books in foreign languages. According to UNESCO, nowadays Jesenin is the most read and translated Russian author. The most crucial part of the main exhibition is Jesenin's memorial room that recreates daily routine and the 20th century atmosphere. Here we can see a vintage bed on which we can find a small pillow embroidered by Tatiana Titova, Jesenin's mother, an antique cupboard, a dinner table, a stool, a chair, and everything needed for house parties and relaxation. By the way, it's a well-known fact that Jesenin and his father really liked drinking tea. Have a look at his room and you'll make sure that it's true. Everything in this room reminds of him. Sergei Jesenin was a very educated, intelligent, and well-read man. It's difficult to imagine the poet without a book, so in his room we can find a bookshelf with plenty of things to read. All books and notes seem to be left by the author himself. In that bookstand, we can also find a small bronze bell that is believed to be brought from Constantinople. In the exhibition, it symbolizes his unbreakable devotion to the native land. Pushkin's portrait bust that you can see on one of the shelves was also a cherished thing for Jesenin, as Pushkin was his favorite poet and writer. The main exhibition stand is made in the form of triptych. In other words, it is quite icon-wise and shows us his early works. Jesenin's portrait, penciled by Vladimir Junger in 1915, catches our attention at a glance. Sergei Jesenin had great expectations about the Russian Revolution. He thought that it would help people to unite and to find a national uplift. These events had an influence on his poems and lyric compositions, but his dreams were not destined to be realized. Day by day, his hopes were fading and only frustration appeared. In 1921, he became acquainted with famous dancer Isadora Duncan. In 1922, they got married. It is hard to believe, but the irony is that Isadora didn't speak Russian as well as Jesenin didn't speak English. Their love was quite painful and very complicated, and as a result, in 1923, they broke up. But people still remember that beautiful couple. You can see their different photos on the right side stand. Sergei Jesenin lived only 30 years, but these years presented us cultural assets like amazing and touching poems, lyric compositions, epic dramas, and epistolary novels consisting of philosophical thoughts and his memories about different countries, especially Russia. His bright life made a great contribution to Russian literature and to many people's hearts and lives.
And funny. Last but not least,
The emphasis of the exhibition in this hall is laid on the family tree of Tolstoy, which stands as a kind of a bridge across eternity, towering above the ocean of time, on the bridge of the most important milestones, persons, and names which have been engraved in Russia's history, politics, military victories, diplomatic conventions, geographical discoveries, cultural and social movements. Among Tolstoy's ancestors, results personal servants, stewards, magistrates, Russian ambassadors, leaders of the aristocracy, thinkers, poets, writers, artists. The first one to receive the title of Count in the 18th century was Pyotr Andreevich Tolstoy, a man of dramatic and unusual destiny. He was a fellow companion of Peter I. In this office, he demonstrated his remarkable talents. In the declining years, he had studied naval science and mastered foreign languages. He was appointed the first permanent Russian ambassador to the Ottoman Empire, became a senator, Knight of St. Andrew. After the death of Peter I, a meteoric rise of his career ended in its complete collapse. He was exiled to the Sovetsky monastery. Pyotr Alexeyevich Tolstoy became the prototype for one of the protagonists of the novel conceived by Leo Tolstoy. For the time of Peter I, she tried to soar as a nun in the Russian life. We cannot but draw our attention to the coat of arms of the Tolstoys, evidences of the long history of the family. We can see the sword crossed with an arrow threaded into the ring of the gold key in the center of the shield of the square. The coat of arms is a reminder of the events of the diplomatic service of Peter Alexeyevich Tolstoy's work. A seven column castle with two overturned crescents symbolizing his release from prison and the triumph of liberation. Two grey hounds sporting a shield have a meaning of a shoe and a rapid success in affairs. We can see the whole interesting portraits of two grandfathers of Leo Tolstoy. Leo Andreevich Tolstoy poses as a typical hostile Russian lord who is accustomed to live in a big way, the prototype of the old country store. Nikolai Sergeyevich Volkonsky can be easily visualized after reading the pages of One Piece relating to the opening of Volkonsky. In accordance with the customs of the time, Nikolai Volkonsky, at the age of 7, was enrolled in military service and as a young man served in the guard. In 1794, Volkonsky suddenly left the service. According to a legend, recently was his refusal to marry Varenka Engelhardt, niece of his Serene Highness Prince Pachomkin. Later, after her marriage to Prince Galitzin, both Volkonskis and Galitzins were on friendly terms and even shared the family portraits. The portrait of the Grand Lady of Catherine Stein was one of the most beautiful women in the 18th century, is on display in our Empire Hall, one of the most colorful and radiant. Nikolai Sergeyevich Volkonsky's service under Paul I was brief enough. He retired for good and went with his daughter Maria Volkonsky to Yasna Polyana, but he has not been devised his state. Nikolai Sergeyevich was a well-educated man, used several languages, was interested in literature, music, theater. He raised his daughter Mary in the same spirit. Unfortunately, he didn't survive. The museum presents two portraits by artist Rogner. One of Prince Mitya Yurievich Trubetskoy, great-grandfather Leo Tolstoy, and the other of his elder daughter, Praskovya Mishiva, the governor, Morgan.
Thank you so much. That was really fabulous. So our next segment was to translate a piece of news taken from the site of a well-known museum, and still this time your choice was limited to two options: the State Museum of Sergei Yesenin and the State Museum of Gulag History. We're sure you've done an excellent job on that, but remember, it's not the quality of your translation only that we judge, but the manner of delivery as well. So let's stick to the set order of groups and
in early 1900s, the house on Bolshoi Stoshenovsky Lane located a residential hotel for the countrymen who worked with the same butchery. As long as Alexander Yesenin, Sergei Yesenin's father, worked with the butcher shop, which accounts for 30 years he lived there in apartment number 6. Sergei Yesenin's first official address in Moscow is associated with Bolshoi Sochinovsky Priulok 24. There are good reasons why. In 1912, he left his home village Konstantinovo and moved into his father's apartment. A memorial tablet referring to Sergei Yesenin's visit was placed on the house front afterwards. The museum antechamber welcomes visitors with opulence of flowers and verdure of the Konstantinovo motley grasses and a hackly Moscow palace. The poet's first impressions of the city was related to this exact view. Later, Yesenin expresses his attitudes and perceptions towards Moscow in such words: "I've seen a lot of things in this world, and Moscow was the best of them." Never-ending line of golden domes represents the inner light and unique elation of Yesenin's poetry. It breaks into everybody's lives, shining brightly as the sun, and appeals to our minds with the immortal image of the poet that is never to be fully understood. The memorial room introduces the spirit of the mainstream Moscow citizen at the turn of the 20th century. A visitor can observe a bed, an antique cupboard, a dinner table, and chairs. All of the items are essential to leading a well-balanced lifestyle, resting, and hosting guests. Sergei Yesenin and his father were obsessed with tea, so there is no doubt that the visitor could see in the usual set that tea drinking requires. It includes a samovar, a special metal device that Russians use for boiling water, a salver for it, copper and teapot kettle, cups, a sugar bowl, and dinner service items. Another thing in the cupboard that may catch your attention is an empty beer bottle. One of Yesenin's letters to Anna Saranovskaya had these words: "I'll drink beer and think of you." In the room there is a suitcase and a traveling bag that looks exactly like it was left by a poet after moving to Moscow. In this bag, Sergei Yesenin brought from Konstantinovo all his treasures, the manuscripts of his poems. The room also reveals Yesenin's personality, his concerns, and attachments. Poets nearest and dearest claimed that Yesenin appreciated fireside comfort. It consists of a comfortable chair, handcraft items such as embroidery, linen towel, napkin bed cover, or even pillow in the case embroidered by Tatiana Yesenina, his mother. In the best corner of the memorial room, there is a generic authentic Kazan icon of the Mother of God that was given to the museum by Svetlana Yesenina, poet's niece. In front of the icon, there is an icon lamp, like an old custom. An old clock, a gift from the merchant, reminds of Yesenin as well. The memorial room reminds us of the poet. There is Yesenin's manuscript, Poet, which was made in this house, a china ink pot, and a quill, as if it were not dry. Sergei Yesenin was a very erudite and educated person. He always was linked with books. Compartmentalized books give us an account of his reading interests. For his whole life, Sergei Yesenin was carried away by classic and contemporary literature works. The most cherished poet for him was Alexander Pushkin, whose portrait bust is put on the bookcase for a reason. Yesenin claimed, "Alexander Pushkin is my favorite poet." Thank you.
Group one, yes. You love here to present.
Festival, Poetry of Palace and the Portable Exhibition, Sergei Yesenin and Max Chagall. Festival Poetry of Colors includes a portable exhibition, Sergei Yesenin and Max Chagall, organized by the Yesenin Museum of Moscow, with a variety of activities in the cities of Russia, Belarus, Germany, France, Israel. The special exhibition, in terms of design, will be based upon the materials and documents from the Yesenin Museum of Moscow. These pages emphasize the creative intercommunication between Yesenin and Chagall. They contain poetry books illustrated with artist paintings and Chagall's letters with his thoughts about Yesenin's works and other things.
The consonance of Yesenin and Chagall's heritage was observed a long time ago. During the life of Chagall, foreign critics asserted, Sergei Yesenin is like Chagall in modern Russian lyric poetry. The same was claimed by the artist. Actually, this essence of our art was similar, but we rarely discussed it at the time. As time goes by, it becomes more and more clear for me that his creation is the closest to mine in comparison with other Russian poets' creative work. Marc Chagall and Sergei Yesenin were contemporaries who had the chance to meet on several occasions, in spite of different faiths. The oeuvres of the great poet and the beautiful artist situated with love to their small motherland, their nation. It's more of life and traditions. Both Yesenin and Chagall imagine their motherland as a bright oasis which breathes honey and roses.
In such a big country as Russia, the issue of search for identity will be fundamental in this exposition, as this problem is especially acute for our society. The exposition will show new faces not only in Sergei Yesenin works, but also in works of Marc Chagall, who was forced to leave Belarus, but has never broken off connection with it. When I was abroad in 1922, I felt like a tree without roots, hanging in the air. I was in agony, I survived, and even if you compare me with a tree, I didn't stop growing just because I have never broken spiritual link with a home.
The exhibition will feature a performance by the jazz band from Kazan, which is called Feelings, with a specially tailored program, as well as a fashion show of contemporary clothes based on folk costume traditions designed by the team Budashki. The festival framework incorporates other events tailored to different audiences. The showroom will have a specific place designed and equipped to allow any guests, children, or adults alike, to step into the shoes of a painter and depict his or her old time valued places worldwide. Thank you for attention.
It's time we had some poetry here. For the final round, we challenge you to translate one of Sergei Yesenin's poems. Sergei Yesenin's outstanding poetry has always inspired readers and translators all over the world. For instance, his famous poem, Anna Snegina, was translated into 12 languages. Our students were offered to wrestle with the poet's not so well known, but nevertheless thought-provoking lyrics, Голубая кошка, синие глаза. Let's see how the hues and colors of this little Russian poem could be expressed in English. So, we are welcoming group 201 here.
My heart will die, I bet.
the blue jean blouse, and deep blue eyes. All I ever said to her was lies. She wondered once, is there a storm? Shall I kindle the fire for you to feel warm? There were few words I could reply. Just now drops are falling from the sky. This fireside will never stop the storm. Come closer, only you can make it warm.
Her pale blue blouse, her navy blue eyes. I hid the truth from my darling. So she asked, is the blizzard rolling? What if we light up the fire and make a bed?
I replied to my sweetheart.
Okay, so we promise not to be long. ready? We hope so. First of all, we want to thank you for the fabulous performance. That was great. And we enjoyed all the moments that we have spent here. And we can praise all the contestants on sticking to the point, firstly, and making the most of all tasks offered. And we have noticed that you are getting better at translating moment after moment. So right now we are moments away from announcing the winners of Translators Day competition. The judges have made their decision, and it's time to reveal our top three in reverse order. However, I want to mention that we don't have the third place. We have the first one, and we have two second places because two groups had the same scores, and actually it differs from the first group only by one point. See, we were at the haunts of dilemma. So the second place, like that. The first second place goes to group 201. Thank you so much. Our second best group, the second best group is 101. And finally, the ultimate winners of tonight are, one moment, that's 302 girls. We would like to hand out our individual gifts and certificates for those inspirational and proactive contestants who contributed most to their team's success. So we will mention six people. So first of all, for the best and most touching poetic performance, we want to welcome Alina Komisarova and Marina Fedorova. Alexey Klashev for the most tourist friendly guide. Right now, Эльвира Геркаева, we would like to mention her for being such an enthusiastic and inspiring leader of today's performance. Thank you. We thank Mikhail Lavinsky for being the most proactive translator and interpreter. Thank you. And finally, we'd like to thank Timur Maziev for being such a computer wizard. Thank you.